Hello, I'm Mizo. Today we are going to have a look at Sabarimala. I'll discuss 12 important facts about Sabarimala, but the 12th fact is a commentary. So you'll have to listen to the 11 points before listening to the commentary. The first fact is that Ram and Lakshman were looking for Sita and they were crossing a forest. When they were crossing the forest, one of the devotees called Sabri was eagerly waiting them. Now, Sabri had an offering of fruits for Lord Ram and Lakshman, but she made sure that all the fruits are sweet. So she tasted all of them, and the one that were not sweet, she threw. So when these half-eaten fruits were offered to Lord Ram, began smiling. The moment he began smiling, Lakshman knew something is going on. So he had a close look at everything and he found that the fruits were half eaten. But he refused to eat these fruits. But Lord Ram himself actually took a special pleasure in eating it. Later on, Lakshman asked Ram that, "Why did you eat these fruits?" So Ram said that, "This has been given to one of my greatest devotees. And she wanted everything perfect. So she did what she knew. And I think this is the most sweetest fruits I've ever eaten in my life." So that was the greatness of Ram. Now, after this incident was over, there was this person nearby who was doing tapasya. Now, tapasya is an extreme form of worship. And you need to have some divinity in you to be able to do tapasya. Everybody can't do tapasya. So when Ram walked up to this person, whose name was Shast is Guru, Shast stood up and he welcomed Ram himself because he immediately recognized that this person was divine. Now this anniversary of Shast actually breaking his tapasya to meet Ram is celebrated as Makar Vilakku Day. It is believed that on this day the Lord Dhamshast stopped his tapasya to bless his devotees. And it's also called Makar Sankranti. Makar Sankranti is actually an astrological phenomena in which the sun enters Makar. And Makar is the constellation of Cancer. So it's got a cosmological significance. Makar Sankranti is also crop festival that's observed all over the world. In fact, it's something to do with the Christmas also has got to the, it's got its origins from there. Both originate the same way. Makar Sankranti is an important festival all over India. And there it is, in that area, it is also observed with a great amount of devotion. Now, the place where this incident happened is the same place in which the temple has been built. And that's why it's called Sabarimala. And there's a number of temples around it. That's why it's called Mala. Now, about Lord Ayyappa himself. Now, Lord Ayyappa, there was this Rakshas, that's a demon, called Bhaisasur. Now, Bhaisasur had this boon given to him that no man could defeat him. And he used to go around in rampages and create problems and go around killing people and doing all sorts of stuff that demons do. But he couldn't be stopped because no man could defeat him. So he took advantage of that boon and he tried to conquer the whole world. Now, when this was happening, Lord Vishnu had to become take the avatar of Mohini. That's the female avatar. So Lord Vishnu took the avatar of Mohini, the female avatar, and then he battled with Bhasasur and he beheaded Bhasasur. Turned out Mohini was a very beautiful young woman, and Lord Shiva actually fell in love with Mohini. And once this happened, they had, from the union, Lord Ayyappa was born. So Lord Ayyappa is the son of Lord Shiva and Lord Vishnu. And this turned out to be very important. When Lord Ayyappa was very young, he was still minor that time. And that's the time when he was a Brahmacharya. This is also very important. Now, as a Brahmacharya, in that area, the Sabarimala area, there was a lady Rakshas called Mallika Purthama. This Mallika Purthama was creating all sorts of problems, going killing people and stuff like that, and generally creating havoc. But her boon was that she couldn't be defeated by anybody except a child of Lord Shiva and Lord Vishnu. And this, she thought that she is invincible because both are men, how can they reproduce? But she didn't know about Ayyappa. So when Ayyappa was born, so this is the reason why Ayyappa was actually created. It was to actually defeat Mallika Purthama. Now when Ayyappa was born, people actually went to him and asked him to actually take care of Mallika Purthama. So he went into battle with her. Now when he went into battle with Mallika Purthama, he defeated her. But when she was captured, suddenly she was actually been taken over by demons. Now when she was captured, the demons left her and she became a very normal young woman. It turned out that she was quite a normal young woman, because after demons left her, she began pestering Ayyappa to marry her. And Ayyappa was a minor, he was a Brahmacharya, he couldn't marry her. And he was too busy with his devotees that time. But the young woman was persistent and she kept on pushing the proposal to Lord Ayyappa and is to create problems for Lord Ayyappa. So when this was happening, ultimately Lord Ayyappa said that to somehow get rid of her, said that, okay, I will marry you, but I can only marry you when my last new devotee comes to me. As long as new devotees come to me, I've got to look after the needs, so I can't marry you till that point. The new devotees are called Kanni Swamis. The problem is, these new devotees never came to a stop. Every time some new devotee would turn up. And the woman was kept out, waiting outside for outside the temple, and the marriage obviously could never take place. Later on, Mallika Purthama got her own temple. And this temple obviously is open for everybody. So if you can't go to any other temple, you can always go to Mallika Purthama temple. The women can go out there. There's no problem there. So that is the reason why women are not allowed in that area. Now this is the old history of Sabarimala. Now in the new history, what happened was that there was this prince who was also called Ayyappa. Now there was a Muslim army led by Babur who attacked that kingdom. And Ayyappa went out to defend the kingdom from the Muslims and he defeated Babur. However, Babur was an exceptional type of a person. After the defeat, he saw the wrong in his ways and he made it a mission in his life to protect pilgrims, because it was a forest that time, still is a forest, is to protect pilgrims that who were going to visit Lord Ayyappa. And finally, a shrine was made to him at Erumali. That is about 40 kilometers away from Sabarimala. So, Babbar has got a shrine in Erumali where people go to ask for protection for the pilgrimage. Now, this is the story about Sabarimala. So, the idea is that Lord Ayyappa was in his brahmacharya position at that point. And that is why he cannot accept women devotees in this particular temple. In the other temples, he can very well accept. There is no problem there. Now, fact number three. Calcutta High Court in 1991 passed... Kerala High Court in 1991 passed an order restricting the age of entry of women below the ages of 10 to... between the ages of 10 to 50. And this was the usage prevalent at that time. And they directed the Travancore Devasham Board to follow that order. These were passed by Justices K. Paripurnam and K. Balaramya Marar. Travancore is the kingdom that preceded Kerala. And all the things you see about Kerala actually is the achievement of the kingdom. It's not the achievement of the communists. All these things they say about Kerala is because of the liberal kingdom of Travancore, who did a lot of things in their time. It's nothing to do with these leftist politicians. But that's another story. Maybe we'll listen to it sometime. Now, this was enforced, the ban on women to Lord Ayyappa was enforced till 2018, last year. Now, on 28 September, Supreme Court of India overturned that decision of the High Court. And they declared it unconstitutional and discriminatory for women to be not to enter Sabarimala temple. And the decision, out of the 5 judges, 4 voted for the order and one was a dissenting judge. The interesting thing is, the 4 who actually voted for the order, they were the men judges, and the single lady judge was the person who actually opposed the order. That's the thing, the women judge opposed the order. However, she was overruled 4-1. This lone woman judge, Indu Malhotra, Justice Indu Malhotra, noted what constitutes an essential religious practice is for the religious community to decide. It is not a matter of courts to decide. That is one. She also added that notions of rationality cannot be invoked in a matter of religion by courts. So, but obviously she was overruled by the male colleagues. Order was passed. Now, on 19th October 2018, two women of Bombay tried to enter, but they were stopped by protesters. Now, the Thantri, he objected vehemently. Thantri, the head priest, and they were not allowed to enter. Then, 1st January 2019, 5 million women formed a human chain called Manitha Mathil or Women's Vault, stretching for 620 kilometers, 385 miles across Kerala. It's not like there are lots of blank spaces in between, but okay. And number two was that it was not a Hindu women's ball, it was organized by non-Hindus. And you can imagine, it's not a phenomenon peculiar to India, that the hijab wearing women were telling other religions that they are not liberated, and the hijab women are the most liberated women in the world. So these are the people who organized it, and of course they were non-Muslims. So it was actually organized by other people to show that us Hindus are intolerant and stuff like that. It's highly objectionable. But anyway, the event lasted 15 minutes and it was peaceful, so I don't think I should have any problem with that. But this was a political move, because the next day, two women under the age of 50 entered Sabarimala after a long period of time. They got in from the back gate at 3:45 a.m., 4 o'clock in the morning, and they entered, and this was counted as a victory by the chief minister of Kerala, a person called Piniya Rai Vijayam. Turns out he's another Muhammad Ghori. He's just that. He's got nothing to do with Hinduism. He's violently anti-Hindu. And he counts that as a victory for him. Anyway, then after this incident was over, the temple was closed to 1 hour, close of 1 hour to ritually purify it. And this is also the chief minister objected to. He's proper Muhammad Ghori, but in a modern form. And now he's threatening to replace all the temple priests. So really he's Muhammad Ghori in a different form. The interesting thing is, both the women who attended, one of them is a government employee, were age of 42 and 44. But one of them is a social justice warrior. She is a communist law professor. So she's got everything about an NPC. She just repeats things that that's been told to her without even considering anything at all. But anyway, they broke that taboo for the first time. Now, here's the thing. This temple is not open throughout the whole year. It is open for the first 5 days of the Hindu calendar. This Ekadashi, Dwadashi, Trayodashi. So the first 5 days is open. And then it's closed. However, between the approximate dates of 15th November to 26th December, it is open for the Makar Sankranti, 14th January. So these are the dates in which it is kept open. And otherwise it is closed. Now you can well imagine, in spite of the restrictions, in Sabarimala, 20 million devotees visit Sabarimala every year. And they all accepted that Lord Ayyappa and Dharmashastra, they are in this particular temple to be visited only by men only. That is the accepted thing by this 20 million devotees, and the SJWs are just showing us down. I'll come to it in the last point, the 12th point. Now, number 8, at Sabarimala, that's the place where Sabri met Ram and Lakshman, and where Shastra broke his tapasya to welcome Ram. The deity worship is Ayyappam and Dharmashastra. Dharmashastra is Dharmaguru, and Ayyappam told a story about him. However, there are 5 important such temples in South India, and then smaller temples all over India and all over the world. The Shastra temples are common all over the world, and you can go to all of them. Now, these 5 main Shastra temples was founded by Lord Parshuram. Now, Parshuram is another avatar of Vishnu. He was a violent Brahmin warrior. He used to go around massacring people. He's famous for that. But at the other temples, there is no restriction. It's only in Sabarimala where the restrictions are there. In fact, there's a temple called Achan Kovil Shastra Temple. In this temple, Lord Ayyappa resides with his 2 wives, Purna and Pushkala. And here, obviously, women are more than welcome in these in this particular Ayyappa temple. Now, this one thing about this temple, this thing, which is a very good tradition, somehow they stopped it. I don't think they should try to open the tradition all over again. In Sabarimala temple, women below the age of 50 used to actually enter the temple premises, but not the temple itself, because they had this ceremony called Chorunu. the Chorunu or Shorunu ceremony is when the infant is given rice for the first time. It's an important function for all men, all children, not men. Even girls get churumulu. Girls get churumulu, basically. So this is all these men who were men and women who were born before 1991, and they were lucky to be have the churunu ritual in Ayappam are the lucky people. Maybe this should start all over again. It is a good idea. Then number 9. This one I can't understand, because 1950 there was this fire and the temple burned down and there was vandalism, something happened. But no charges were brought. Nobody is prosecuted for this. Now the stone, it was originally a stone image that was replaced by a panchloha. Panchloha is a alloy of 5 metals. That's why it's called panchloha. And all over India, you have these idols. Here the idol is 1.5 feet. And panchloha idols are very expensive if you buy them in America. So all of panchloha idols have been smuggled to America. That's another story altogether. So you come to number 10. Now, the main entry to the temple is through the 18 sacred steps. This is called Panthinettu Tripadikal. Now, the Panthinettu Tripadikal is open only for special devotees. All devotees can't actually enter through these 18 sacred steps, which is covered by gold. There is another stairway in the northern gate, which is open for everybody. Now, what is special about that? If you want to go through these 18 sacred steps, you got to carry a Irumuthikettu. Irumuthikettu is an offering of ghee and other stuff, traditional offering, that is carried in a Palikettu or a Irumuthi. These are two compartment bag made of hand woven cloth. And this is, you got to carry it on your head. However, it's not only about carrying this offering. Before carrying this offering, you got to go through a 14-day vratham, this vrat, in which you have to eat very plain food, avoid contact with women, and also you have to do something good, visit the temple, wear some clothes so that people identify you as in that you are doing some vrat, and you got to tell the truth, which is probably the most difficult part of this. So anyway, after going through this 14-day austerity period, then only you can climb this 18 stairs. So it is not that anybody can simply go there and become a devotee. It's not simple. You can obviously go out there through the other gates. Now we are coming to the last important points, because we come to the prasadam. This is number 10. Number 10 is the prasad that is offered at Sabarimala. This is called the Arvana Prashayam, Payasam and Appam. Now, Payasam is sweet meat. This is prepared by rice, ghee, sugar and jaggery. This is all Hindu temples basically have that stuff going on. So they have their old traditional prasads, and Sabarimala prasad is made in this special way. And now we come to the 11th part, which is now we are hearing that part. This is recited before the gates are finally closed in the night. So after everything is over in the night, this particular sloka is recited. All the famous singers of the area have actually sung this sometime or the other. This is also one of these versions. And you can just listen to the devotees doing it. You can listen to the divinity in the song itself. It is great. Now we come to the last 12th part. What will be the result of this? The the four justices who passed that order about Sabarimala, I don't blame them, because they have grown up in this system which is anti-Hindu, and the government has been fashioned over a period of 1300 years, which was is totally designed to crush Hindus. Unfortunately, after the independence was over, this didn't stop. This went on and on. In fact, it became worse. So, under our so-called secular government, Hindus have been treated like pieces of meat or something like that. We don't count at all. And maybe the time has come to change that. As far as Sabarimala is concerned, the entry of women is not such a big deal, because they'll have to have a cleaning ceremony before closing on the temple and singing the song or hymn. If you listen to the whole song, it is great. You can hear, listen to it on the YouTube, by the way. Now, after all this stuff, eventually the court is not going to decide anything. It will finally come down to the devotees and the Lord Ayyappa himself. Hinduism is a very tolerant and open religion, so it is not a big deal for us. Every individual devotee will decide what to do, and all the women who belong to these families, their entire families, the 20 million people, they also will decide what to do. The Supreme Court can't make that decision. They can only force Hindus to do all sorts of things, but they can't make their decision. And I think what the devotees themselves decide, in fact, the female devotees, what they themselves decide is more important, as far as I am concerned, than Supreme Court justices, who probably are brainwashed by anti-Hindu stuff that they were taught in college and, in fact, the whole of their lives. With this, I come to an end of this talk with you. It is quite an emotional thing for the devotees of Sabarimala, but I think all the Hindus are with them. Thanks for listening in, guys. This is Mizo. I am signing off.